bit of extra money on the side, you know. And so I pulled my sweatshirt up, showed him a scarred forearm. The moment he saw it, he realised, because he's a diver, he said, "Oh, we sub." I mean, we Daniel. He said, "Pardon, Stephanie for you. You dive with Simon tonight." Lamont said, "We." He said, "Pardon," carrying me in his arms, he raced me to the hotel. Near the swimming pool, there was the bar, and the Chinese owners that ran the place had closed the bar, so all the tourists had gone to bed, but they were there gambling, playing mahjong amongst themselves, drinking whiskey. As these Chinese men looked at me, they said, "What's wrong with you? You drunk?" I said, "I'm not drunk. I'm dying. I need to go to Katsuma Hospital. Please help me. I've been stung by a poisonous jellyfish." And as I'm speaking this, Danielle takes off into the night. As these men looked at me, I said, "I'm trying to explain." They said, "We don't understand you. What you say? We don't understand you." I said, "My arm, I pulled my sleeve up. It had worked for my friend just a minute ago. Thought if they see my scars on my arm, they might realize I'm in serious trouble." So I pulled my sweatshirt up. They saw the scarred forearm. And the Chinese owner, he stood up and said, "Whoa, what you do, you stupid white man? You put the needle in the arm? Oh, the old man, he take the opium, huh? Well, putt, why you put the needle in, you stupid white man?" I'm sitting there going, "Where's Danielle gone? These guys think I'm a drug addict, and I'm nearly dead." As I sit there, I see out of the corner of my right eye, my fingers start twitching. As I turn, I see muscle tissue between my knuckles going into spasms. Within a few seconds, my whole arm starts to tremble. It moves up into my face, and my teeth begin to literally be smashed into each other as my jaw goes out of control. Next minute, my entire face and body is in what I call the death rattles, muscular contortions, shaking to bits in front of them. As this deadly shaking's going on, I watch the Chinese men run towards me and try and hold me down. As they do, I'm throwing them off like rag dolls. My body comes out of this deathly shakes, and I feel go through the core of my body an icy cold breeze, like very, very cold. So I'm freezing, man. They ran and got blankets. The old guy thought I must have taken a poison in my stomach. He tried to pour milk down my throat. At least he was thinking. As I'm sitting there, I feel the poison moving into my bone marrow, and not the poison, but death, like an icy cold death, necrosis, moving into my bone marrow and coming up towards to my upper body. As I'm sitting there, I know if this necrosis hits my upper body, I'm going to die in front of them. I'm gone. I'm dehydrated, paralyzed, muscular contortions, now necrosis setting in. At university, I'd done veterinary science as one of my subjects, and I did my degree in agriculture, so I knew from my own physiology I was in serious trouble. I had to get to the hospital. I turned, looked in the car park of the hotel, one vehicle. I recognized it instantly to belong to the Chinese owner who was now standing next to me. I said, "Sir, your car. Could you please take me to Katsuma Hospital or I'll die in front of you? Please help me, sir. I'm nearly dead, eh? Can you take me in your car?" The Chinese man, he looked at his car. He put his hand on my shoulder. He said, "Oh, my car, huh? Cannot lie. How come you're so worried, white man, huh? We have ambulance for you. Don't worry, huh? Cannot take my car. We have ambulance for you. How come you're so worried?" How come I'm so worried? I'm about to die, mate. You feel like hitting someone?
Yes.
I mean, I'm not an angry person or a vindictive kind of, you know what I mean? I'm not. I'm pretty mellow, but I tell you what, I felt like punching his lights out. I sat there and every part of me thought, how can I rearrange his face? You know, you hate it when someone touches you? You know what I mean? They're just in your space. Well, he's not only in my space, he's in my face. I thought I'll hit him. I was just about to plant him one, but my arm wouldn't respond. My mind was saying, smash him. My hand wouldn't move. I thought, great, it's paralyzed. I tried my left hand, it moved. I thought, what on earth could I do with my left hand before I died? I thought, my forehead, I could give him a headbutt. So I mean, play a lot of rugby at home, you know what I mean? Every now and then you get in some pretty heavy stuff. So I'm about to rip him down into my forehead. As I'm about to do that, this voice comes again. It said, "Son, if you do that, the adrenaline rush will kill you. The toxin's too close to your heart." I thought, that's true. I looked away. I thought, if I survive this, I'll find you. I mean, I'm going to get you, Jack. You're history. I'm staring out here, controlling my anger, again wondering what this voice was. But it had literally just stopped me from killing myself. As I looked away, trying to control it, my anger, I watched my friend Danielle come sprinting towards me. Next to him, another security guard. As they grab in their arms, they carry me towards the entrance of the hotel, and I see as they're carrying me, the headlights of a small vehicle comes flying into the car park. As I see it come around, it's an ambulance. Small Renault with an ambulance written on the side of it. The guy that's driving it doesn't see us because his headlights miss us, and it was a Creole that rang them, so they thought the boys must be stoned or drunk or off their face, false alarm. The Frenchman driving it changed gear and drove out without even stopping. He didn't even come in. As he took off around the corner, I'm slung between my two friends watching this happen. I think you're in a Grand Prix or something. And I can't whistle. I'm dehydrated. My friend lets me go. Chases after the guy whistling, doing a huge wolf whistle, trying to get the guy's attention. Fortunately, he stops him in the road before he gets up onto the main road. The guy backs up. The other security guard throws me in, you know, gets me into the ambulance. We take off. As we race towards the hospital, it's on a ridge, but they inadvertently put my feet in the front seat. My head's in the back seat. As I begin to climb the ridge to where the hospital is, the toxin that's now in my lower body starts to naturally drain down into my lungs, into my heart, and I feel it starting sweeping into my brain, and I feel compartments of my mind literally shutting down with the poison. It's a weird sensation, but I knew I was dying. As this continued to happen, I start to see on the inside of the ambulance what appears to be a small boy with white hair. I see sections of some kid's life with snow white hair. I then realize as I'm looking at it that this is me. This is sections of my own personal life. I thought, am I that close? With my mind, I did a mental check, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Of my own vital signs. My mind told me I am very close to death. As I'm lying there, I think, well, I could be that close to death. I may not make it. I thought, if I don't make it and die before I get to the hospital, what would happen to me? Is there life after death? Or when a man dies, is that it? Finished. Cessation of life. Well, as a heathen, as an atheist, I reckon when you died, it was all over. The trouble was, I wasn't sure. How many know you can be wrong? You know what I mean? Ever been wrong in your life? Well, I was a gambler, and I'm gambling with my life here. I think, hey, if I'm wrong here, I'm gambling. It's like Russian roulette. I could be wrong here. I have no idea what will happen to me if I died. As I lay there, I began to see appear now before me my mother. As I saw her, I was amazed because as I looked at her, I could see she was praying. I thought, what's my mum doing here? As I saw her praying, she looked straight up into my eyes. She said these words. She said, Ian, no matter what you've done in your life, son, no matter how far from God you may be, if you'll but call out to God from your heart, God will hear you and God will forgive you, son. I thought, forgive me? God? What's all this stuff about God? Is there a God? I had no idea until I returned back to New Zealand that at that precise moment on the other side of the world, my mother was on her knees praying for me. She's the only believer in our family. And she had prayed every day of our lives, all the kids, the whole family, every day, every one of them. And God had just spoken to her in prayer and said, your eldest son Ian is nearly dead. Pray for him now. I thank God for a woman who knew God and didn't give up on her son and kept praying even to the end.
Please don't miss part two of this three-part series when Ian McCormack will reveal what he experienced when God spoke to him face to face. Some of you might be saying, how can this possibly be true? I want you to know that with God, all things are possible. Believe me, I know. Until next program, goodbye.
You've been watching Revelation, the program with a biblical perspective.